Good evening to all. I am Mariette Westermann, Vice Chancellor of NYU Abu Dhabi, and I'm eager to welcome you to the sixth Vice Chancellor's Roundtable of this academic year. In this series of discussions, we have conversations with leaders in the UAE in many sectors of society and the economy, public and private, local and international, large and small, medium size. We learn about the fundamentals of various industries and civic endeavors, and we learn about change, adaptation, success, and sometimes failure and what we can learn from it. We gain perspective on careers, on different ways of being a leader, and on crafting lives of purpose and contribution. We hear how leaders reflect on their education and what it has meant to their trajectories. Thus far this year, we have spoken with leaders in real estate and urban development, banking and finance, media, film and communications, and just this week, diplomacy and international relations. Today, my guest is Badr Jafar. I hope he will turn on his camera. Welcome, Badr. Badr Jafar is a very distinguished business leader in the UAE and well beyond. We will talk with him about that, but also about the large role of philanthropy and civic activity in his life. I will introduce him in a minute. We will then talk for 50 minutes or so. And as always, we will take your questions through the Q&A box in Zoom. You may post questions anytime, and I will weave them in as we can, and we'll also leave some time at the end for more sustained questions if there are some. Wide range of topics. We also, as always, are recording this and can make the content available afterwards, because many, of course, of our students might be in classes or engaged otherwise, and we want as many people as possible to learn from these very wonderful occasions. So Badr Jafar, as I've already said, is a businessman. He is also a social entrepreneur from the UAE. He is the CEO of Crescent Enterprises, a diversified business that operates across six industry sectors in 18 countries, as we'll hear. And he's president of Crescent Petroleum, which is the first independent and privately owned petroleum company in the Middle East. He also serves as chairman of Gulftainer, the largest privately owned container port operator in the world, and chairman of Pearl Petroleum, which is a very large natural gas producer in the Kurdistan region of Iraq. Badr is actively engaged with a diverse range of nonprofit organizations and initiatives. He's focused on humanitarian aid and international development, corporate governance, entrepreneurship, education, and the arts. And all that work he executes in many different ways, and it includes serving as a member of the UN Secretary General's high-level panel on humanitarian financing. Badr is also the founder of the Pearl Initiative, a nonprofit, private, sector-led organization that is committed to promoting a corporate culture of transparency and accountability across the Gulf region of the Middle East. And he does so in cooperation with the United Nations Office for Partnerships. He is also the founding patron of the Center for Strategic Philanthropy, which is based at the Cambridge Judge Business School at the University of Cambridge. And that center is dedicated to enhancing the impact of strategic philanthropy, a term we'll talk about tonight, both within and from the world, one of the world's fastest growing economies here in the UAE. He is incredibly thoughtful about education, as I have had the pleasure to learn, and he serves in that context on the UNESCO International Commission on the Futures of Education. He is a very busy man, and I am very, very grateful that he is joining us tonight. Welcome, Badr.
Great pleasure and honor is mine. Thank you, Mariette, for having me.
Wonderful. Let's get started. So when our students see and read and hear about an influential leader in so many fields like yourself, they often find it a little hard to imagine how one gets started on such a trajectory. Could you tell us a little about your career journey?
So as with most life journeys, you begin the journey not knowing where it's going to take you. And as you grow up, you have plans, you have dreams. But as they say, if you really want to make God laugh, tell him about your plans. So the, you know, expecting, I guess, the unexpected is has to be a fact of life that that you embrace. And it'll serve you well to embrace the unknown by building healthy flexibility in your plans. I was born and raised in the UAE in Sharjah. I went to the International School of Shuaifat in Sharjah. I left to boarding school in the UK at 16 at Eton College, and subsequently went to the University of Cambridge, where I studied engineering, some astrophysics, and some business. And then I ventured out into the so-called real world. My first taste of business, I think, was fairly on in life, starting with a baseball trading card business at the age of 9, and also a bunch of other ventures. And also, of course, by attending meeting after meeting with my father as he went about his work. I personally couldn't wait to end my formal education. I always felt like I'd learn more about the business world from business itself. This, of course, isn't a recommendation to anyone to cut their education short, stay in school, as they say. But I was certainly raring to go after I graduated in 2000, almost 21 years ago now. Time really does fly by. But it was there was, I guess, some expectations to join the family business, but I already had so many different business ideas that I wanted to pursue when I left university that I effectively became an entrepreneur, starting a host of different businesses, including a fashion accessories business, a business-to-business e-commerce platform for the energy sector, which was early days of e-commerce back then, a reality TV concept years before the Big Brother TV show took off. All became revenue positive. However, unsurprisingly, most of them failed, except the fashion business that I ran for almost four years, and that I sold for a healthy profit to a major Japanese distributor after growing it to 60 stores in Japan alone. And worth adding that whilst my family had means, of course, they were not keen on the prospect of me starting a fashion business. So I took out a small business loan of £50,000 at the time. This was in the UK after I graduated. It was from the Royal Bank of Scotland to get that business going, and managed to pay it back that loan within three seasons, which is why I'm a huge advocate for greater lending facilities for small businesses and startups themselves in the region, which unfortunately doesn't exist in the way that I believe it should do. So I invested the money that I made from that fashion business into a number of other people's ventures as venture capital. And again, as expected, many of them didn't do well, but a few did very well. And I've been investing in venture ever since. I eventually joined the family business a few years later after a few months of employment contract negotiations, which at the time was predominantly an energy business here in the UAE. My main objective was to help grow the energy business into different markets and also to diversify the overall family business into other strategic sectors for two main reasons. One, to hedge against the energy business, to spread risk, if you will, which is a key purpose of any diversification strategy. And two, to prepare ourselves as a family business to embrace new sectors that were likely to have a major impact on our economic and social landscapes here in the region and elsewhere. And that was through the creation of Crescent Enterprises, which in just over 15 years is now responsible for generating over 70% of Crescent Group's revenues.
It's such a journey. I just have to pick up a few little details of it that were definitely not known to me. Baseball cards, where did that come from? I associate that with, as that's for an 11-year-old, in the UAE, maybe you were already in boarding school. I don't think so.
I was nine. So it was before my time. I was selling it to 11-year-olds. It was just something that at school became very, fashionable, I guess, to have a baseball card collection. Not necessarily just baseball. It was sort of basketball and other sports, but it was very difficult to get your hands on. There were only one or two stores. There was one small store, I remember, in Al Ghareer Center in Dubai that sold them, but in limited quantity. So I basically imported them. I started importing them, and I set up two or three stalls in various malls selling them. And they did very well, of course, with a very healthy markup at the time. Until years later, other much larger distributors got caught on to the opportunity, and it became much more available, and then I shut down those stalls. But yeah, I was nine and ran it for a few years, and it made good money, far more than I would have gotten from pocket money.
Amazing. Sorry, and already then you knew when to get out too.
But precisely. Well, that one was easy. You get out when people stop buying because they can get it elsewhere cheaper.
Well, that's a wonderful story. And can you tell us a little bit about you talked about then joining the family company. What do you think you learned in the earlier startup efforts, some of them successful, some a little bit less so? What did you learn and take back into the family business with you?
Well, they were diverse, and I think that's one of the things that I certainly brought into the family business, which is that element of diversity. The Crescent itself today is a very diverse business, predominantly through Crescent Enterprises, which has these four different platforms. And so I think embracing diversity and not necessarily just putting all your eggs in one basket was one, principle that I took to the family business when I joined it. And then in terms of personal learnings, it was that of really failure. I mean, like I said, the majority of those ventures failed, but they taught me a lot about myself, as well as about certain things that work and perhaps don't work so well. So bringing that learning into my entrepreneurial journey within our family business was obviously something that was not just important, but was something that I felt needed to be also passed on to everybody else that we came into contact with. And one of our ventures, one of our platforms today, does invest in small businesses and ventures across the region. And this, we don't expect that every single one of them are going to be successful. We certainly don't expect that every single one of them are going to be successful immediately. So working with them through their own iterative journeys of learning from failure and growing is something that, as I said, I lived myself. So I guess I have a lot more empathy working with young entrepreneurs today who are going through that experience themselves.
Mm-hmm. Can you describe for our audience the range, these four platforms of Crescent? What are the core businesses that you work across?
Sure. So, I mean, just a little bit about diversification, I guess, because we just talked about that. And, the main, I guess, thrust of diversification is to build economic resilience, right? Especially in the face of turbulence and volatility. If you choose to keep all your eggs in a single basket, then you'd better watch the basket super closely, because if it drops, then you're in trouble. Of course, diversification itself is a journey, and there's no one-size-fits-all approach. Crescent Enterprises itself evolved over the years, but a few years ago, as I mentioned, I structured it into four distinct but connected platforms that together employ today over 4,000 people and represent 41 companies and investments. And the platforms all have names that describe what they actually do. CE Operates, which covers all our operating businesses, including Momentum Logistics and Gulftainer, which is today the largest privately owned port operator in the world. CE Invests, which is our strategic late stage investment platform that invests predominantly in private equity and in other structured investments. CE Ventures, which is our corporate venture capital arm, that I launched really just over 2 years ago, and through which we've already invested over $150 million in high impact startups in the Middle East and internationally, In fact, we just allocated an additional $30 million towards biotech and deep tech investments to be deployed within the next 6 months. And finally, CE Creates, which is our internal business incubator, established to continue the legacy of entrepreneurship, coupling business incubation with inclusive social impact. So it really covers the life cycle of business activity from startup to larger, more mature businesses and across numerous sectors strategically selected. Our capital allocation across varied geographies and sectors and verticals ultimately reduces our exposure to any single asset class or market. And I guess the unprecedented disruption caused by the COVID-19 pandemic this past year helped us to gain new insights and perspectives into the importance of this diversification strategy, which in turn helped us to not just weather the storm, but also to take a number of steps in the last year that should enable us to emerge more resilient and hopefully more or better prepared to face other challenges in the future.
We'll probably talk about it a little bit more later on, but I am curious whether that decision to step up investment in biotech and innovation in that sector, is that a direct consequence of COVID-19, or was this pretty much the way you saw the world going anyhow?
So the biotech and deep tech space is one that we identified as an opportunity well before COVID, and we had done some investments in that space, but it became clear that we needed to build better in-house expertise if we were going to really deploy large amounts of capital. So we started on course to building that in-house expertise a few months before COVID hit. And I think what COVID demonstrated, like with many other sectors, is just an acceleration of a trend in certain directions. And obviously one direction being the biotech space, which has now taken off even more vigorously than perhaps it was even before COVID. And the same with deep tech. So I think what COVID did in so many ways, and again, it affected each industry differently, but it helped to highlight certain deficiencies in our global economic as well as social landscapes, I guess helping us all to see the gaps that needed to be filled. Now, filling those gaps aren't necessarily something that we can do overnight, but I think at least I hope it helps us to channel our energy and capital towards filling those gaps. And I mentioned, not just economic landscapes, but social landscapes. And the two, I think, need to be much more closely intertwined if we are going to not just cope with future crises, but hopefully have a chance in helping to stop them before they happen.
Also something we'll definitely want to come back to in a minute. I always, here's a question that students often encourage me to ask, but when I am asked it, I am always hard put to give an answer, so I tend to skip it, but I'm not going to skip it with you. And this is, you are CEO of Crescent, impressive range of platforms, President of Crescent Petroleum, Chairman, as I've said, of Gulftainer and Pearl Petroleum, and you're involved in all these voluntary and nonprofit activities, not just as a matter of just supporting them with a contribution, but really you get involved in their governance, you serve on boards, a lot of civic service. What does a typical week or day look like for you?
I think no such thing as a typical day, and that's how I like it. I thrive on diversity between energy, logistics, venture capital, business incubation, and nonprofit humanitarian and development work. There's never a dull moment, believe me. Look, some people prefer to be, I guess, one-track focused, and there's nothing wrong with that. For me, I like to take learnings from one discipline to help inform and inspire another, and with the intention that together they are greater than the sum of their parts. And whilst it might seem chaotic, I see it as being all part of the same canvas and linked together by the same strong sense of purpose, which is to create inclusive value through sustainable enterprises that generate economic and social impact, and really done in a way that where there doesn't need to be a trade-off between one and the other. And I've always believed in this, and I still and I instill this philosophy, if you will, in everything that I do, and I hope to be able to continue to do so.
In other words, a lot comes your way, but you also have to be very organized, keeping track of it all, I would think. Yes. And let me ask you, since those things are together, and I think they are reciprocal, I certainly believe that, do you, you know, in managing the administration of these different parts, do you keep them separate, or do you have one master chief of staff who keeps track of all of it for you? Your board so requirements.
You mean the four platforms under Crescent Enterprises, or everything? You mean so outside Crescent Enterprises as well?
Yeah, because you have such important government responsibilities. You know, can you keep those things sequestered? Even though in your head, of course, this all relates to making meaningful society. Tell us a little bit about your work practices. Students are really interested in that.
Yeah, no, so they absolutely have distinct governing structures. I don't have them all combined under one sort of umbrella governance. They each have their own governance structures. But personally, I need to always try and find ways where one can take advantage of synergies, even through personal learnings. You know, as I mentioned, bringing learnings from one to help to perhaps refine and enhance the other. But of course, through and through, applying good corporate governance across all four. So maintaining, of course, healthy distance and arm's length distance between each of these ventures. And that applies, both in the for-profit and non-profit world.
Very much so. You mentioned that you couldn't wait to get out of university to get things done. I thank you for telling people to finish their educations nonetheless. It's a good thing, I agree. But there's so much informal education. And in that way, as you described your learning, are there particular mentors or people who impacted your journey along the way, whether in university or outside?
Look, for me, education is a lifelong journey. And with the rate and pace of change in our world getting faster, not slower, the sooner we embrace that concept of lifelong learning in our societies, the better. So while university degrees are still important because they are valued by our existing economic systems, everyone should really think of education like a skill that needs to keep being honed, otherwise it will wither. If I had to pick one thing that had to pick a lasting impact on me, it would be my exposure to community service, to be honest. This was actually at Eton College, as part of your formal education, you were encouraged to do a few hours of community service a week, from teaching third graders maths to spending time with terminal patients at local hospital, to helping get groceries for the elderly. Phenomenally impactful experiences that helped align priorities for me and helped overall in helping to define a compass point for purpose in what I do. And this is also why I have for many years advocated for better community service programs here in the region, with more formal, or better, let's say, formal opportunities for volunteering and simply just getting involved in your community. I've written and I continue to speak about this missed opportunity, but let me just provide some context, right? We obviously have a huge problem with youth unemployment in the region, pushing 40% in some countries, which is by far the highest in the world. It's sadly only getting worse. To add to that, it's estimated that more than 10% of working hours in the region were wiped out in 2020 due to COVID, which is the equivalent of 24 million full-time jobs. So we absolutely and urgently need to create opportunities for youth to apply themselves to. But that doesn't need, or that doesn't just mean jobs. In fact, I think a single-minded focus on job creation prevents us from seeing the true challenge and opportunity that lies ahead of us, and that is instilling a strong sense, again, of purpose and a feeling of belonging within our youth. You know, the recent global risks perception survey by the World Economic Forum, which was published a few days ago, clearly highlights youth disillusionment and erosion of social cohesion as critical short-term threats to the world. Therefore, in parallel with the overwhelming challenge to create tens of millions of meaningful and productive jobs, we urgently need to deploy all the tools at our disposal to strengthen the fabric of our local communities, including through things like community services I mentioned. And I think education and the educational experience, I mean, as I just mentioned to you, my first exposure to that was through my formal education. So I think, again, as with all very strong societies and economies, again, an education system that helps to really bring out the best sort of humanity in the person will serve us extremely well, particularly as we go into a world with increasing uncertainty and challenges, and where perhaps those human skills are going to be the most important skills, also, you know, within businesses and jobs that one could wish for.
Thank you for that very important statement on community values and the risk that we lose a generation that might be hopeless in that sense, without hope. And I think that this is a very important role for all of us anchor institutions in society to play. So thank you for bringing that out. Your businesses, this is one particular value, I think, that you promote. Your businesses are known for championing sustainability, a challenge initially, of course, for the energy sector in particular. Can you say something about what this agenda means to you, and how do you drive that vision for sustainability? That's also a matter of inclusion and equity, ultimately. How do you drive that through your business platforms?
So from my point of view, sustainability is not a goal in itself, right? It's a way of thinking. It's a way of being, a compass point, if you will, for businesses and individuals alike towards balancing three things, really: social, environmental, and economic factors in harmony with one another. You really do need all three to make it work. And what this boils down to when you strip away all the jargon and platitudes is your purpose again. It's, you know, as an, again, as an organization, your raison d'être, if you will, your reason for being. And I can't help but feel that there still is a misconception where we're playing some sort of zero-sum game with our businesses, where there must be a trade-off between profit and purpose. The notion that you have to give one up or compromise on it in order to generate some of the other. I've strongly disagreed with this notion for many years now. And on the contrary, I believe that a business without a clear purpose today is likely to be an unsustainable business. The best businesses align profit and purpose, and the most sustainable ventures in the long term will always be the ones that have an authentic cause built into them rather than as an unintended consequence or as an afterthought. So this principle really runs through all of our activities at Crescent Enterprises. And we've woven sustainability into our operating fabric. And we gauge our business performance, not just on financial results, but also on our contributions to environmental, social, and governance objectives. So we do that really across all our platforms. And we also strive to report on it and as transparently as possible. We've been publishing now, in fact, this year will be our 10th anniversary of publishing a sustainability report. We used to publish them as two separate reports. So we'd have an annual report and then a sustainability report. As a private business, we don't have to publish either, but I felt it made not just sense, but it made, you know, from a transparency perspective, but also, you know, as they say, transparency, not just for transparency's sake, but it's a phenomenal tool for building trust with your broader stakeholder group. So that's why we published these reports. But in 2017, I believe we combined the reports into one report. It's an integrated report where we report on, as I said, not just the financial, but also social, environmental, and also governance metrics. And when the SDGs, the Sustainable Development Goals, became hot, we started to also benchmark against those 17 different goals to see how our impact as an organization was benchmarked against those 17 goals. Which of those goals were we generating most impact in, and where perhaps we could do better, and all, of course, towards, you know, the sort of world's agenda and mission to achieve those goals by 2030.
It's great to hear that the SDGs have remained important for you in such a direct way. I have not heard that much, actually, in private enterprise. Universities talk about them, but it seems sometimes as if the world has already given up on a lot of them. So it's good to hear that you're hanging in there. It raises an interesting question to me about how you, staffing your organizations. You know, how do you build your teams, and how do you, so what qualities and attributes do you look like, or how do you try to build them across these platforms, and then maintaining this ethos and direction of travel on these values? How, can you talk a little bit about actually the nuts and bolts of that, hiring and developing staff?
So, you know, the skills that we look for obviously varies from one situation to the next, but I guess universally important values include honesty and integrity, creativity and thinking, and good old fashioned roll up your sleeves, hard work. And by hard work, I don't necessarily mean long hours, right? I mean, really giving yourself heart and mind into what you do. And because the best results inevitably come from that, right? And my job as a provider of jobs also is to create opportunities for other to deploy their passion into. And if I do my job properly, the result is a community of people, each with their own diverse interests, backgrounds, and styles, but working as a single community, again, of purpose towards the same objectives.
And so, you know, that means making sure that all your different sectoral leaders in the first place have that attitude and share those, that outlook. Yes.
Yeah, look, again, I'm very strong believer in again, embracing diversity. And I believe that the by far the strongest societies are societies where diversity is embraced. And I don't just mean gender diversity, although that is, of course, incredibly important and a huge missed opportunity within our region itself. I'm talking the Middle East more broadly. But diversity across all aspects, including demographically, and, you know, culturally and ethnically, and now, of course, with a fantastic drive towards also inclusion of people of determination, which the UAE in many ways championed. It's fantastic to see many more organizations also now bringing those employment policies or expanding those employment policies to embrace diversity more authentically. And so, you know, as I said, on a societal level, more diverse societies are inherently stronger societies and over time more successful societies. And similarly on an organizational level. So the balance is, of course, embracing diversity whilst at the same time ensuring that there is a common strong sense of purpose and a sort of zero tolerance in many ways for breaking from a set established set of values and principles that you have as an organization. So that, and again, as I said, it's a fine balance and it evolves over time. And with an organization like Crescent Group today, which does span, as you've mentioned, and as I talked about, multiple different sectors, I think those guidelines are what keeps us going and keeps us hopefully growing as well.
you speak beautifully about a value-driven organization or organizations in your case. Can you say a little bit about how maintaining that sense of community, pushing purposeful in one and through hard work in one direction, how have you been able to do this during the pandemic? How have you kept up with the teams?
So we, like many organizations, fairly early on adopted a remote working sort of platform. We made the best use of technology, of available technology, to have all of our engagements virtual. And it certainly added challenges. There were, you know, particularly I would say with the newer business ventures that were still on the sort of creative path to figuring out exactly what they were as businesses and how they were going to address certain challenges. They would have, you know, understandably multiple team meetings every day that would sometimes go on to the early hours of the morning. But doing that virtually wasn't easy. But history has written already over the last 12 months, most companies, I think, managed to get on with it. Productivity was just as strong. There were aspects to it, in fact, which made things perhaps easier. That there was a lot of time, I wouldn't say wasted, but used, getting places and helping to, you know, between getting into meetings and starting the meeting and then demobilizing after a meeting, that when you add up all that time, it makes up a lot of time. So I think the biggest thing that I missed during that, during this whole 12 months experience was those bits in between, because I always believe that sometimes, you know, the space in between is where the magic happens. It's those, inspiring conversations you have in the corridors, unexpected exchanges that you have, that you can't curate for. And so that was more complicated to do via Zoom and via Teams and all the other platforms out there. But for the most part, we learned a lot. There's certainly some practices that we're going to carry forward. But I think many of my teams are very much look forward to getting together in person much more regularly than they are today.
Inshallah. It's nice to hear you say what you missed the most in the past tense, because I do think we feel the end of this coming, which is it can't be a moment too soon. So that is very, very important. Inshallah. But did you find as a leader that you communicated more frequently even than you would have through town hall type activities, regular memos and so forth, or is it about the same pace?
I think I communicated just as regularly because I was always very accessible, but it was to a larger group of people. Hmm. So I think many of the calls and the meetings we had, I would make it a point to invite more people into them. When you're in a conference room, you know, which only fits, you know, 10, 12 people comfortably, sometimes having a sort of roundtable discussion with more than that number ends up becoming a conference, not a meeting. But I found that it was easier to have more people present virtually. So I guess the meetings did get bigger, and I felt it was also important whilst people were working from home and remotely away from the office to make them still feel all part of that community, involving them and engaging them in those conversations I felt more important. So I think the frequency was probably the same, maybe a little bit more, but the inclusivity of the approach was perhaps enhanced.
Yeah. I think that was pretty much my experience as well, though we had to communicate more frequently than we would have, I think, across these different constituencies, of course, that we have. Let me ask you one more question about governance and transparency, and particularly your founding of the Pearl Initiative about 10 years ago as this private nonprofit organization committed to promoting a culture of transparency and accountability across the broader MENA region. What motivated you to create this initiative, and have you seen corporate culture evolve in the region?
So as you mentioned, we got together with peers, I guess, in business from across the Gulf region about 10 years ago now, in 2010, to create the Pearl Initiative. We did it in partnership with the UN Office of Partnerships at the time. And it was really, and it still is obviously, a non-profit by business for business organization to champion the business case behind governance and corporate governance and sustainability also in the Gulf region. The need for the initiative was clear. Over 85% of non-oil GDP was generated in family private businesses, and trillions of dollars was being transitioned from primarily the second generation to the third generation, in the years ahead. And as we know, statistically, the transition from the siblings partnership to the cousins consortium, which is the second to third generation, is fraught with problems, where globally only 15% of families survive beyond the third generation. And this is primarily, and actually only 5% survive beyond the fourth generation. And this is primarily due to governance, to corporate governance failures. So that's why there was a huge opportunity and perhaps an urgency to build this coalition of businesses from the Gulf region and also to include multinationals to promote the business case behind embracing good governance and with a view really to protecting and indeed enhancing value creation in the private sector. And of course, in turn, to help to generate more job opportunities across the region. 10 years on, of course, I think the mission has become more relevant for a number of reasons. First, I think there's been a proliferation, obviously, of startups in the region, as well as the growth in the SME sector more generally. We've seen, of course, in the last few years, increased emphasis on ESG, environmental, social, and corporate governance across all types of companies and organizations. And I think the Pearl Initiative has been able to position itself to help to address the G, the governance angle, and meet some of the growing demand in the region for tools and information in the space. And I think it's also worth mentioning that we've witnessed across in the region an increasing amount of institutional philanthropy that's taking place in and from the Gulf region. If you combine those opportunities together, that in many ways has formed the Pearl Initiative's next 10 years vision and plan, which it just recently launched. It's called PI Vision 2025. It looks at 5 years, the first 5 years and the second 5 years of the second decade. But we're going to really double down on the governance and SMEs program and also include startups, the anti-corruption best practices, diversity and inclusion, also the governance in family firms, but also on the verge of launching a governance in tech program, which will cater to the unique governance challenges of rapidly growing tech companies across the region. So it's exciting times for the organization. It's grown in over the last 10 years, but I think the next 10 years is going to be really where it sort of comes to really embrace the opportunities ahead of us. I mean, there are, again, many companies today that see governance as a business imperative, many more than I think did see that in 2010. So I'm hoping that engagement with the Pearl Initiative will be fundamentally aligned with business objectives, as opposed to a CSR activity, if you know what I mean.
Yes, we actually have a live question about this here from Maral, saying that she was among the first team from the Judge Business School. We'll get to that school in a minute, but from the Judge Business School working on the Pearl Initiative. And she has a question as well and says, you have been ahead of the game on ESG. I would say that is right. And on ESG reporting and also advocating it through this broader Pearl Initiative. Do you believe the pandemic was an accelerator for ESG reporting and ESG investing in the region and globally? Or could it set things back? What do you think?
I think it's an accelerator, so it's a double-edged sword. I think, yes, it's an accelerator on the reporting front. And you will see many more companies today feeling pressure to report ESG practices and impact. The reason I said double-edged sword is because the other side of it is that I hope that people don't just start focusing on the reporting dimension and really, really embrace ESG and what it stands for more authentically in their business models. So I'm seeing a lot of activities, including with many consultants. I have nothing against consultants. We use many consultants. But I'm seeing more effort going into how to design good reports as opposed to how to fundamentally look at what perhaps needs to change in the practice of business and business models in order to embrace more sustainable and inclusive future, if you know what I mean.
No, I that is very powerful to me, because although I think reporting and sunshine are very important, it's only one part of accountability. True accountability starts somewhere deeper and in a more fundamental way, I think. Reporting is a necessary mechanism of it. Wonderful points. Here's also someone is very interested in you're thinking about teams and including more people in the meetings as you can in the Zoom or Teams room or BlueJeans conference. And they love this idea. And this person asks, you know, building that connection is of course very good. How do you make their participation meaningful without too many cooks in the kitchen situation? How do you stay productive, I guess?
So it depends on the number. If it's 10 people, 15 people, then you give everybody an opportunity. You dedicate certain time to allow people to put their hands up. 15 minutes, you know, the end of a meeting, 15 minutes, everybody has an opportunity. If time runs out, then you obviously need to address some of those points offline, or you address them on your next call, and we have daily calls. If it's a larger group of people, then the way I do that is asking people to contribute certain ideas or questions before that meeting, because then you can go. What we often find is people have the same sorts of questions, so you can consolidate and then address those and answer those. But where they are distinct, we make sure that they are raised and brought up during the meeting itself. So I think it depends on the nature of the meeting as well as the number of people on that meeting, but it really can be quite a powerful tool. And that's why I said we are going to carry forward some of these kind of virtual online gatherings, even when we're all able to get together in person a lot more frequently than today.
It's a wonderful point. We've certainly found that attendance at our faculty council meetings or all university town halls is so much greater. And we do precisely what you say. We source a lot of questions in advance and then sort of order them and try to get to as much of it as we can. But I hope we can hold on to these inclusive practices. It seems essential. Let us turn for a moment to the questions around strategic philanthropy, philanthropic investment, that are also so core of how you think about the whole of your enterprises. So the word philanthropy, you and I talked about it before, it can mean a lot of different things to different people. Could you briefly orient us to your understanding of philanthropy and what strategic philanthropy means to you?
So I think a philanthropy is private capital for public good, but I think for far too long, philanthropy has been treated like the neglected child of our capital system, seen by many as a peripheral player and sometimes regarded with a high degree of suspicion. The reality is that over $350 billion of private philanthropic capital is deployed every year in and from the region alone. That is more than the annual global development and humanitarian aid budgets combined. The UAE is considered by the OECD to be one of the world's largest provider of development assistance in proportion to its GNI, its gross national income. However, that even the tens of billions that our country has very generously donated over the past years is still a fraction of the amount of money that flows through the world's private philanthropic channels. So this is a huge space, and we need to think about strategic philanthropy as more of a mainstream intervention, right? Another tool at our disposal to help us overcome our greatest challenges and to help plug the estimated annual gap of $2.5 trillion that we need to fill if we are to have any hope of achieving the SDGs by 2030. Just a quick point about strategic philanthropy, because I think that it is and will continue to be a very important and high value part of that equation. All right, strategic philanthropy is a term used to describe any form of impact-driven giving that's evidence-based and utilizes creative planning, agile execution, and diligent follow-through in order to achieve the intended results. And it encompasses a wide range of practices from traditional grant giving to newer models for generating impact, such as venture philanthropy, as an example.
Well, that's a very good description, I think, of how you define strategic philanthropy. As you know, I worked for a large American private foundation, a particular animal in philanthropy that traditionally was sort of charity, like support the good of humanity in visionary ways, but a little bit ad hoc in this broad rubric of arts and humanities in my case. And the 9 years that I spent there, if I reflect on it, and there was a lot of retooling in strategic directions where we really learned a lot from corporate philanthropy and more impact investing, the way you've just described it. And what I came to think about it, and I'd like to ask your view of it, I came to think that why philanthropy was really needed as something that wasn't in the first place business oriented, it's business oriented in some ways, but that was its own place, was that governments could never take care of all the problems of humanity, although I think the role of governments is very important. On the other hand, the market left to its own devices, as is so often thought would be a good thing, also won't take care of everything. So I always thought that strategic philanthropy was best deployed somewhere in the middle, but also finding a way to bring really good ideas from kind of the nonprofit space or something a government might not fully do to market in some way. Is that a way kind of where you would position strategic philanthropy, somewhere between the wild open market and free market and the and kind of very directed government intervention?
So I think it cuts across the capital system in many ways, because, and I think it can play a very important role as part of this blended finance practice that we see happening more. Philanthropy can be a great de-risker because it can fill some of those gaps that you just talked about. And I've seen many, and that's in many ways what venture philanthropy is about. I've seen that work extremely powerfully in spaces like healthcare, where, you know, if you look at, you know, take rare diseases as one example, where there's a very high risk profile for starting out on trying to create therapies or treatments or cures even for rare diseases, where you might be spending, you know, many millions, tens of millions, if not hundreds of millions of dollars before you know whether you have even a chance of tackling that disease or curing that disease. So where you can bring in sort of rare disease world, where you can bring pharmaceuticals, both big pharma as well as a new venture pharma, together with private foundations who fund the exploration of and development of new treatments, it can be a very powerful combination. And I can name a number of examples of treatments that have come about through that union. The same thing with government. I think the practice of social impact bonds is a great way where philanthropic capital can be deployed to effectively address societal challenges that the government can't necessarily do, either because they don't have the bandwidth financially or in terms of other resource-wise, or they don't necessarily understand or have the expertise to go about addressing a particular challenge. So the launch of social impact bonds has been a very powerful example of where philanthropy can unite with government in some cases to address societal challenges. Again, there's that de-risking element. So that's why I said I think it can cut across really all sectors. And I think for the region, the reason I'm so excited about what the future holds for philanthropy in general is because we're really only at the start of that institutionalized thinking behind philanthropic engagement and output. We have for many years, many centuries, thousands of years been engaged in altruism and in helping the other. It's part and parcel of who we are as people from across this region. But I think the professionalized, institutionalized, and strategic nature of that giving is something that is relatively early days here. And I think that I'm excited because I've seen that when done properly, really helping to generate a multiplier effect on impact. And some of these tools we just talked about, like venture philanthropy, impact bonds, et cetera, these are all just tools to help you have that multiplier effect for you to generate more impact for the same dollar value or dirham value in the UAE's case.
Very thoughtful indeed. I am sure that you love all your philanthropic children. Can you tell us one area that you're especially thrilled with how it turned out, pleased with the change that it made, small or large? Just give us an example of what's giving you incredible pleasure in achieving through your strategic philanthropy.
So let me, maybe I'll answer that in the context of something called the Giving Pledge.
I'm very interested in your view of the Giving Pledge. Please explain to everybody what it is. Yeah.
So the Giving Pledge is something established by Bill Gates and Warren Buffett and to encourage people to give more money effectively. And you sign a pledge where you pledge to give away half or more than half of your wealth over your lifetime towards causes that are nearest and dearest to your heart. Now, I think it's a great initiative. The focus, again, as I said, is on the act of giving. Being very honest, it took me a while to wrap my head around it because I was more interested in the how of giving than the what or the quantum of giving. So in essence, I was more interested in working on the quality of giving. Which is why I talked to the Giving Pledge team about the idea of an impact pledge, where pledgers could pledge to make a specific impact during their lifetime or solve a specific problem related to a cause close to their hearts. For example, someone could pledge to eradicate poverty in their country or region, or to bring an animal species back from near extinction. I felt that building communities around causes was perhaps a more exciting way to go about building these powerful networks rather than focus on the billions of dollars involved. Of course, I fully respected and understood Bill Gates's and Warren Buffett's approach. And I spoke to Bill a number of times about this. And I guess their objective, their primary objective was to try and keep it simple by focusing on the quantum of giving and really just more giving. And that, of course, generated a lot of interest across the world. My pledge, which is available online, was an impact pledge. And I focused on what I am most passionate about, which is working to continue to improve the infrastructure of giving, helping to enhance governance around giving, and also to continue developing tools to enhance the impact of giving. And these efforts will hopefully help to generate that multiplier effect that I spoke about, right, on the impact of giving more broadly. You know, if you use the analogy of not giving fish, but teaching fishing instead, my approach is to make even better fishing rods so that the fishermen and fisherwomen can catch fish faster and hopefully also have a lot more fun doing it.
That's a very good analogy. And certainly perspective I share. I think there you referred to the structure of giving and the potential philanthropy in the region. I want to ask you something about that, because of course, to me, coming to the region and to so many of us at Emirates Abu Dhabi who came from other countries here, we are very impressed with the tradition of charity in this region and in the country. And more broadly, Muslim culture, of course, has a beautiful tradition and obligation of charitable giving. And yet there is something of a difference, as you've begun to show, between that kind of charity freely giving to, you know, what people who are in need, altruism, true altruism, and philanthropy as you've described it. How would you talk about that difference, and can you draw on the one to support the other, to make the other more present in this region and country? How do you explain to people what you're doing as opposed to traditional zakat, for example?
So look, the Middle East obviously has a long and very rich history of charitable giving. As I mentioned, I think we have perhaps a shorter history of institutional philanthropy or structured philanthropy. And there is a distinction, you know, that's actually quite common in many of the emerging markets, not just the Middle East. Until recently, it wasn't always possible to even set up a nonprofit organization in many countries in the region, including in the UAE. It certainly wasn't easy. And I think there are various reasons for that, but it led many people, to go and set up nonprofits outside the country. So I think this is a huge missed opportunity. It's being embraced a lot more today, especially when you consider the quantum that we're talking about, right? So you mentioned zakat and sadaqah. For those, of course, not familiar, zakat being compulsory almsgiving, and sadaqah being discretionary almsgiving. Today, anywhere between $400 billion to $1 trillion a year is disbursed in Islamic philanthropy every year.
Enormous.
This is huge. I mean, at the high end of that scale, that's more than triple the annual global humanitarian and aid budgets combined. So on the one hand, that's fantastic, right? Because that's a huge amount of money by any standards. That's annual. However, where is that money going, right? What impact is that money generating? Is it being combined with other, as we discussed, sources of government and business capital to address the world's most urgent challenges? The reality is we don't always know, but when you look at, just take the Muslim world, for example, you know, 1 in 3 Muslims today lives below the poverty line. 1 in 3 Muslims lives below the poverty line. Then you ask yourself the question, is that money really being deployed to generate maximum impact? So that for me is, I think, where the opportunity lies. Which is sort of why a couple of years ago, I put together a team to launch a new initiative called Hasana. That's a nonprofit tech-enabled platform that's designed to streamline the Islamic giving process and to ensure that more of the funds raised through Islamic giving is being allocated as transparently and accountably as possible to impact-driven philanthropic projects and organizations around the world. It's currently undergoing beta testing. You can check it out on hasana.org, hasanah.org. And, you know, it's, again, as I mentioned before, what I'm keen on doing is working on the infrastructure, but also developing tools. This is one example of, I think, a tool that currently doesn't exist that hopefully, if it takes off, can hopefully help many, many people connect with their giving also more strongly, and perhaps also see more transparently the impact return, the social impact return on their giving. The good news, I think, more broadly is that attitudes to philanthropy across the region and really across the world in many of these emerging markets are changing, especially amongst young people. And one of the biggest drivers of that is the new amount of wealth that's being generated in the region. And I think the associated rise that's taking place, the younger people's, awareness and interest in more transparent and accountable philanthropy. And so, it's exciting, as I said, but I think the earlier we help to instill these principles and practices, the better. They say, as always, prevention is the best cure. So the earlier we work on this, not just you know, not just across society more broadly, but also, you know, educational institutions. That's why I set up you mentioned in your introduction, this Center for Strategic Philanthropy at the University of Cambridge, which focuses on strategic giving in and across the world's emerging markets with a view to helping to enhance the impact of that giving through actually in the case of the center, through three tracks. One is research. The second is convening, bringing people together to have these important conversations around giving in their own markets and through their own cultures. And the third is that education and training dimension. So the center has been up and running for about 10 months now, but I'd love to see similar centers or initiatives in other centers of academic excellence around the world, which is why you recall I mentioned to you, Mariette, that I'd love to work on establishing something like this at NYUAD, if that's interesting to your stakeholders and your students.
Well, it's a wonderful idea. And I think Hassan.org, everybody, do look at that. As you say, I think there's so much to build here and to build on, because it's a strength. The fact that philanthropy is sort of bred in the bone here is very important. But then how do you use it? Those numbers you mentioned about poverty, for example, and lack of education are very striking. So the Center for Strategic Philanthropy, you've just introduced it at the Dutch Business School at the University of Cambridge, focused on emerging markets, importantly. I think there's lots of knowledge about philanthropy in wealthy countries, long-established countries. I think it's a good idea to place it there. Here's a question from the audience. What is expected from the Center of Strategic Philanthropy from your perspective? As the patron and founder of it, what are you hoping to see?
So, you know, you mentioned the broader opportunity. Before I answer that question, again, just to put that in perspective, right, the seismic shift that's underway now across the global economy, the top 30 fastest growing economies in the world are all today in emerging markets. And it's estimated that over $5 trillion in wealth is going to be passed from one generation to the next within these economies over the next 10 years. So this also suggests that we can expect to see a significant rise in philanthropic activity in these societies in the coming decades. And that sort of, I guess, leads into the answer to your question, which is, what is the overall hope for a center of this nature? It is to help to enhance, however which way possible, the impact that philanthropic capital is going to have as it's dispersed within the markets themselves, but also from those markets to the rest of the world. Many philanthropists across the region here, but also across many of those emerging markets, whether it's in Latin America, sub-Saharan Africa, developing Asia, are now becoming increasingly more active globally and are dispersing significant funds towards global causes. So wherever there's an opportunity to help enhance the impact of that capital, that is precisely what the center is going to be guided by. Now, the other dimension is one of partnerships and collaborations. And this applies across any sector, right? Whether it's business or nonprofit, education, together you can go further, right? And so where is there opportunity within the philanthropic sector for people to work together, for people to try and learn from each other, from each other's mistakes, but also from each other's successes? We're hoping that a sort of, you know, nonprofit center of this nature, independent center of this nature at an academic center such as the University of Cambridge can also help to bring people together and encourage more partnerships and more collaborations. It doesn't always need to be about money being co-invested. There are many different types of collaborations and partnerships that can be formed around philanthropic ventures, or even just the practice of philanthropy in itself. So hopefully a center like this can help to try and connect some of those dots, because very powerful things can happen when you bring people together who have, you know, the same purpose and mission, but helping to pool their own resources together and again, create that multiplier effect.
And is that why, because that was, I was so curious about that, as you know, is that why you placed the center in a school of business?
Well, so that's why I placed the center at the University of Cambridge, interestingly, because the original idea between you and me and everybody listening was to have it here. And, you know, I'm from here. I'm in the region. I'm proud Emirati. And so I wanted, you know, a center of that nature to be here. But thinking about it further, you know, I mentioned the importance of independence. And so I felt that if the center's objectives was just philanthropy within the Middle East or within the UAE, then of course it's a no-brainer. But I felt the opportunity was for it to be across emerging markets. And I felt if it was based in any one specific emerging market, then it might compromise its independence to serve all of those markets. So that's the reason why it was in Cambridge. The reason why it was the Judge Business School is because I strongly believe that there is a lot that philanthropy, for strategic philanthropy, can learn from the practice of business. Not that you're trying to make sort of, you know, nonprofits or foundations more business-like as such, but there are certain practices from a sort of governance perspective, as well as the heightened awareness around impact that business has figured out the hard way over the years, that I think could help to inform philanthropy. Similarly, I think as businesses start to, question their own fundamental purpose as being more, you know, agents of society, and being able to, you know, and repositioning themselves within society, there's a huge amount that businesses can learn from philanthropy and from the philanthropic systems as to how best to align their own objectives and purpose with the needs of society, right? Because that's fundamentally what philanthropy is about. So cross learning between the business world and the philanthropy world is why I felt it made a lot of sense for it to be based at the Judge Business School, which is the Cambridge Judge Business School, which is the business school for the University of Cambridge.
It seems a wonderful choice for these reasons that you've thought through so carefully. We have more wonderful questions from the audience. So they're going to come a little bit random, but they pick up a lot on what we've talked about. Here's a question from Maya. When evaluating a startup for impact, how do you measure or quantify its potential social impact? Does financial return or its impact matter more? Do they intertwine? Is it always true that it's a total win-win? How do you evaluate a startup for impact?
So primarily, understanding what the purpose of that, what problem that particular startup or venture is setting out to address and solve. So before you even look at whether it can do it sustainably from a financial perspective or other perspective, it's really understanding or getting to grips with that. Has the venture leader or the entrepreneur behind that idea really understood the problem that they're setting out to address and solve? And if that is articulated, depends on what stage the startup is. If it's just an idea phase, then there's no evidence yet. So you have to go with coming to terms with, or helping the entrepreneur come to terms with that issue that they're going about trying to solve. If they have some track record and they've gone about already generating some impact, financial or otherwise, then you can really dig deeper into those metrics, both qualitative as well as quantitative, to really see whether that fundamental purpose is being addressed. Now, to the question, is it always possible for you to have that, you know, wonderfully combined holistic approach to societal impact without in any way there being a compromise or a trade-off? The answer is it depends on the timeline you're talking about. I think in the steady state, I fundamentally believe that there is no trade-off. And there shouldn't have to be, as I said, that zero-sum game where you have to give up one to create the other. In the steady state, you will have enhanced economic value and financial returns if you are delivering on that social promise. In the short term, though, from year to year, yes, you may have some compromise, which is why for venture specifically, and when I say to entrepreneurs who are looking for venture growth, for venture capital for growth, they need to make sure that they find investors and venture capital that is aligned with the long term. Because many funds today that are, 5 year ago vintage or 3 year ago vintage, they have to generate certain returns over a certain period of time. Otherwise, it's going to mess up their numbers. And if you choose to take money and to accept venture capital from those type of firms, you're going to be scrutinized on a maybe not quarterly basis, but certainly annual basis. On your numbers, on your financial returns and numbers. And that might add some pressure and force you to cut corners on your social mission. But there are, we pride ourselves, this venture capital, this corporate venture platform that I established called CE Ventures, we're long-term. We're happy to be invested in someone for decades if we feel that what they're doing delivers on their original promise. And of course, we'd only be invested in them decades if they were also financially sustainable, because they wouldn't be around for that long if they weren't. So we don't have the same, complexity as maybe institutional venture capital does. But aligning the nature of money with the nature of the venture itself is extremely important for you to have that healthy marriage. But if you want to chat more about this, then please do feel free to connect with me offline. Very happy for Mariette and her team to connect really any of you with me. If you want to chat through any of this further.
I'm sure there will be a lot of uptake. I love the way you described how you evaluate a startup venture, because it sounds exactly like how I would evaluate a PhD proposal. Is the thesis statement or question there, and are the resources and the research program lined up to answer it and be successful? It's a very similar discipline. So I can see the academic way in some ways in which you approach all of these questions. Here is a question from Mohammed about governance. Does government have a role in private sector governance?
Yes, absolutely. So governments are extremely important facilitators of good corporate governance. And they do that through a combination of incentives and disincentives, right? Rewarding good practice and punishing and penalizing bad practice. So, and that's done through a series of laws and regulations around what companies need to do and need to refrain from doing. My thesis, though, which is why I established the Pearl Initiative, is that rules and regulations alone will not lead to the behavior that we need to see. Even in the most advanced governed or regulated markets in the world, you've seen major collapses because of fundamentally a lapse of corporate governance. My thesis is that until and unless businesses really identify with and embrace the business case behind corporate governance, then you're never going to see those attitudes change, and you're never going to see the rate and pace of change that we need to see within our governance network. So fundamentally, again, people need to realize, businessmen and women need to realize that it's in their vested self-interest to adopt these governance practices and not just try and box tick what the government lays out it needs to do. So I think it needs to be a joint approach, but simple answer, absolutely. Governments have a crucially important role to play in corporate governance.
Another fascinating question from someone here is, I was often asked, Bennett Mellon, and we spent a lot of time thinking about it and not ever completely satisfactorily answering it properly. So here's a hard one. How does one engage in philanthropy without reinforcing existing social hierarchies or inequalities, I guess is what I'm hearing there?
It's the same rigor and discipline that you need to apply with everything that you do, even in business. There are many business practices that if you're not careful, you can exacerbate certain problems. And in fact, as we've seen, you know, the rate and pace of inequality and the inequality gap growing around the world is primarily due to that. So it's at the moment we don't have regulations or enough, I guess, smart regulations. It's not about quantity of regulation, but smart regulations to help to deal with that inequality situation that you face. I'm talking now on a sort of macroeconomic perspective, but drilling down into philanthropic practice, it's the same advice I give to social entrepreneurs who are going about trying to address problems. Really taking the time to understand the problems that you're trying to address and the problems that you're trying to solve, and really following through, even theoretically before you go about doing it, the potential impact. In some cases, you know, trying to think about the unintentional impact that your deployment of capital, or philanthropic or other, can have in a certain space, and really seeing whether you're achieving your issue or whether you might perhaps be even exacerbating certain challenges, which I think you alluded to with your question. And I can think of many social enterprises, I won't name them, but many social enterprises out there that have a great feel-good nature about them. When you know, the tagline sounds wonderful and the elevator pitch is even more wonderful. But when you really look to see what the life cycle impact of that venture is, there's been unfortunately many negative consequences associated with how that venture has panned out. And I think similarly with individual giving, you need to be very careful, whether it's individual or institutionalized, really think through what the impact of that giving is going to be. Stress test it. You know, use devil, you know, as I said, you know, whether you have a formal philanthropy or not, you know, whether you have a board or not, boards can be very useful putting things to. But if you don't, as I say to people, create like your own personal board of directors to help to bounce certain ideas off, stress test them, find a good devil's advocate to throw an idea and tell you if you're missing something. It's really rigor and discipline and due diligence. And then the last thing I'll say is making sure that you build in agility into and flexibility into your giving, so that if you need to change after a certain period of time because of what you've learned and the lessons you gained, then you can change and you can pivot. And you need good data to help to inform your giving over a certain timeline as well.
Excellent hedges. Saifuddin here is very interested in, you know, how in your talent picking strategies and tactics, maybe. From your point of view, what is the best way to find team members to start a new business, and how to measure their passion and commitment?
So that's really why I created something called CE Creates. This is our internal corporate incubator. And this is really an opportunity for everybody in our sort of community, our employees, to keep thinking creatively about problem solving. It could be related to an existing sector that we have, or it could be even outside any of our sectors. And we have a system where people can propose ideas. We have a sort of filtration system where those ideas then go through certain filters, and the best of them, as defined by certain metrics, become incubated. And if that individual is interested in incubating it themselves, and if we feel they have whatever skills are required to incubate it themselves, we'll let them champion them. We'll take them out from their existing job and make them the leader of that particular venture. If for whatever reason they just have great ideas and they don't necessarily want to run it themselves, but they want to contribute with ideas, that's totally fine. They can stay in their existing job, and we will build a new team around taking that venture forward. So that's what CE Creates is. And so far we have 7 business ventures that's been launched. 3 of them are, in fact, 5 of them are revenue generating. 2 of them are now profitable. Of course, those are 7 from maybe, you know, 300 that we have, you know, assessed over a period of maybe 3 years or so. So that's one way, I guess, to channel that creativity, if that answers your question.
incubators are critically important. Our Start AD at Emirates Abu Dhabi has that similar ethos, I would say.
Yeah, and we've been, and that's a great venture, and we've been involved with Start AD from the start also.
It's wonderful. Quickly, a few more, as much as we can get in the next 3 minutes. MOAD is known for entrepreneurial spirit. Many of our students want to be social entrepreneurs in particular, but other kinds of entrepreneurs too. What do you wish you knew starting out with your own business after graduation, if you'd known it?
Could you repeat the question?
What do you wish when you look back at your early business ventures? What do you wish you had known upon graduation that you didn't?
I could give you a whole list of things that I've learned that would come in handy today, but it's the journey that matters. Really, it's the journey that matters the most. So what I've learned along the way through failures more than successes is what makes me who I am today. And so, you know, people often ask the question, you know, who do you aspire to be and who are your sort of role models? And, you know, of course, so many amazing people out there that, you know, one can take a lot of inspiration from. But I like the saying that someone mentioned that, you know, your optimal role model is yourself in 10 years. It's really aspiring to be the best person you can be. And that journey over 10 years is going to make you the person that you are in 10 years time. And again, with everything that you learn. So in a nutshell, I'm glad I didn't have all those so-called experiences when I first started out, because I wouldn't have been able to properly absorb and learn from them, from those experiences, if I did.
Great answer. I never know how to answer that either. So that's good. Now I know how to do it. Talk about 10 years now. What do you hope will be true about philanthropy in the region in 10 years?
Well, aspirationally, more strategic, and I think I sort of defined what I mean by strategic, more collaborative. I'd love to see, you know, more concrete examples of collaborative philanthropy in the region. The third I would say is more mainstream, you know, not seen as some sort of kind of sideshow that people do if they've got lots of money and then, you know, they don't know what to do with it, but really as part of mainstream intervention towards addressing our regional challenges, of which we have many, of course, as everybody will be aware of. So it coming into the fold as part of mainstream intervention is something that I would love to see as a trend over the next over the coming years.
That is a wonderful goal to shoot for. Certainly in MOA Abu Dhabi, we hope to be part of that journey. We are ourselves a philanthropic community within our own community, but we also, of course, constantly work to develop more good ideas and bring resources to help us do that. So we hope to be very much a part of that journey. Badr, we are so grateful to you. This was a great conversation. I'm sure there are so many more questions, and indeed, offline, we may pick them up with you. Thank you very, very much. Thanks, everyone, for tuning in and posing so many good questions.
Truly an honor and a pleasure, Marriott. Thank you to you and all your team. And I very much look forward to visiting again your beautiful campus in the not too distant future, inshallah. And again, very, very happy to connect with any of your students offline. So thank you very much.
Great. We'll do it again, inshallah. Have a wonderful evening, everyone.
Thank you, and you. Bye.
Bye-bye.